Hi, I'm Bryce Crittenden.
Hi, I'm Caroline Land, and welcome back to EPL's Overdue Finds.
Caroline, how's it going today?
I'm doing well, Bryce. How are you?
Good. Really good. It's funny because we are recording this on a Monday morning, and it seems like it's been like almost like, I know we have episodes come out every other week, but I think like we haven't recorded an episode for like, it seems like a month or something like that.
It's been a while. Sometimes, you know, based on scheduling, I mean, obviously it's ideal if we give our fabulous editors some time to work on the show and get everything ready so that we can release it. But sometimes, you know, we're just running up against the deadline and so it has been a while, but it's good to see you again.
It's Monday morning. We're recording. It's first day of the Stanley Cup playoffs. So go Oilers. I love this time of the year. Got baseball starting, hockey starting. There's so much fun stuff to watch on TV. And one of those things that I've been enjoying lately, thanks to Overdue Finds family member Kathy Bateman, is the new CTV comedy, Shelved. And what's cool about this show is that it takes place in a fictional Toronto public library. So we thought, like, we got to talk about this show on the podcast, and that's what we're covering today.
Yeah, it's so if you're out there and you've got, you know, about 20 to 30 minutes between a hockey game and a baseball game, check out Shelved.
Yeah, absolutely. So a few years ago, we actually did an episode called Libraries and Pop Culture. You can go back and kind of find it in our archives and everything. And so we were like, when we heard about this show, we're like, we got to talk about this. And so the show just started. It's on Monday nights on CTV. And short little half an hour sitcom. We're going to be giving our thoughts on it today. I can't wait to hear from you, Caroline, because obviously yourself and our guests today are branch managers. So you will definitely be bringing a totally different perspective to your thoughts on the show than I will as somebody who works in marketing. So, of course, we want to welcome back to the show. She is, I like to call her the best friend of Overdue Finds. And she's the host of our Capital City Press anthology podcast, which you can check out every other Friday when we're not releasing episodes. Kate Gibson. Kate, how's it going today?
Hi, thanks for having me back. It's going well. It's sunny outside. I'm loving the warmer weather.
Absolutely, yeah. And I was going to say, I was looking back through my notes, and it looks like the last episode you were on was back in September for our 1987 pop culture time capsule episode. So it's been a while since you've been on, and I know
it has been. I can't believe it's been so long. Like, where did the winter and fall go?
But I know it's absolutely just flying by. So I'm really excited to get. I have lots of questions, actually, believe it or not, for you and Caroline today, as people who run a branch. Mm-hmm. And I'm watching mm-hmm. this show, and I'm taking notes, and I'm just like, what? And like question marks. I'm like, do branches feel this way? I got to get Caroline and Kate's thoughts. So,
I love that you have these questions, Bryce, because I have to say, while watching it, I was just doing kind of a lot of nodding and a lot of like, And I mean, obviously things are heightened for comedic purposes. And but there were definitely moments where I'm just like, yep, that's that. So I'm looking forward to hearing what you thought of it.
Yeah. So this is going to be a fun one today. But before we get started talking all about Shelved, let's share some of our recent Overdue Finds picks. Kate, I know you've been super busy with all things Capital City Press, but what have you been enjoying lately?
I actually just got a book that I wanted to share. I've started reading it. I'm about not quite halfway through. It's called The Once and Future Sex. I'm going to show it to you too, even though our podcast listeners can't hear. So it's called The Once and Future Sex, Going Medieval on Women's Roles in Society. It's by Eleanor Janega, who is a historian out of London. And it really takes a look at medieval sort of ways of thinking about gender that has informed sort of our current ways of thinking and how it's quite different in some ways too. So really cool. She's got a blog that kind of got me onto her to start with. So yeah.
Nice. What's the name of her blog?
Going Medieval.
Oh.
Yeah.
I know nobody can see it, but I did kind of mention that I love the cover for it. Caught my eye. I'm a huge, we've talked about this before. You can judge a book by its cover. So it has a great cover. And it looks like you purchased that book.
I did purchase this book.
And that's fine.
Bryce is going all library. Bryce is going all expose on this one.
I did because I knew I'd love it and I wanted to have it for my own collection, but we do have it in the library. I think we have 6 copies and an ebook if people are interested. There is holds on it though, so get your name on the list if you're interested. Really fascinating. She's a fun way of talking as well. It's almost conversational. It's not dry, academic. It's very, very as if you're just talking to a very smart person who knows a lot of stuff about medieval society. But she's so relatable. So I'm having moments where I'm just reading it and I'm chuckling, and then I read it aloud to my roommate. And I'm not sure if she's appreciating it or not, but I think it's really fun and funny the way she talks about medieval gender roles. So
nice. Yeah, that sounds really interesting. And yeah, I can't imagine the research that goes into something like that anyway. So
it's quite broad ranging too. Like she talks from, the ancient like Greek philosophers, Aristotle and Plato, and what they thought, the difference between men and women were, and all the sort of their quote unquote science around that to, Thomas Aquinas up to modern day ways of thinking about it. So she goes across the gamut.
Caroline, how about you? What have you been enjoying lately?
Recently, I rewatched a movie that I saw for the first time over 20 years ago. And I don't know, I might have talked about it on the show before, but Bryce, are you familiar with a little masterpiece called Center Stage?
I am familiar with it, but you're probably not going to be shocked to learn that I've never watched it before.
Okay.
Because there's no car chases in it, right?
No, but I love because there's no car chases, but in the final ballet, a motorcycle does come on stage.
Ooh.
So I don't know. Kate, have you seen Center Stage before?
I don't actually think I ever saw it. I know of it.
You know of it. Okay. Yeah. So for people who maybe aren't as familiar with it, it is a movie that came out in 2000, and it's about a young girl who is selected to train at the American Ballet Academy, and her name is Jody, and she dances with a lot of heart, but her feet have terrible turnout. And if you miss that the first time, they're going to tell you that over and over and over again. They do not stop talking about Jody's feet in this movie. Anyway, she gets there and her roommate turns out is a dancer named Eva Rodriguez, played by Zoe Saldana in one of her first movie roles. And Eva has a beautiful technique. Her feet do whatever they're supposed to do, but she has a bit of a bad attitude because ballet has not been the most inclusive. And, she doesn't really see herself as part of the ballet establishment. Now, there's also this bad boy of the ballet world who was having a relationship, I guess, with his dance partner. Then she decided she was going to get married to the head of the American Ballet Academy, who is played by the actor you probably most closely think of when you think of, who could be a ballet dancer? And that would be Peter Gallagher. The dad from the OC, not really a traditional ballet mode, but anyway, he is apparently one of the best dancers of all time. Now he runs the American Ballet Academy. The soundtrack is set to Jamiroquai and Red Hot Chili Peppers, and you know there's this tension between living your dreams and you know, what do you do if you're not kind of right for the world that you want to be in, and how much are you willing to sacrifice for something that you think you want? All of this like comes together. Jody is in this like weird love. It's the softest love triangle you've ever seen. Anyway, and she with Cooper, who's the bad boy, they kind of get together, but she thinks it's really serious and he's just like, I'm just, you know, having fun. And so she gets her heart broken. This all culminates in the workshop, which is the biggest deal ever. And in this, Cooper, who has seduced with like his charm this wealthy New York woman who I guess has money to burn, she's ready to fund his ballet academy if he can prove himself as this choreographic genius that everyone is saying he is. So this all again comes together at the workshop, which involves Peter Gallagher choreographing for some of the dancers, but Jody has the lead in Cooper's ballet, which is a so thinly veiled recreation of the love triangle with Peter Gallagher and Cooper and the other woman that Cooper actually plays himself in the dance in the final. He's on there. It's there's traditional ballet, there's this modern movement where they like wheel this bed out on stage and they like have dance sex during it, and then you realize later that Jody's parents are in the audience, and it's like Then Cooper comes in on his motorcycle to disrupt the dance world. Like, I can, like, this, there's a costume change on stage where her hair completely, it goes from being, like, down and loose to up in braids. And it's just, like, a camera trick, but it's not, like, there's no way this could possibly happen. But you don't even care because you are swept away by the magic of dance. And that is the beauty of this 2000 masterpiece, Center Stage.
Wow.
Any questions?
Wow. I have so many questions, but...
Yeah. So, big shock, but traditionally a movie about ballet is really nothing I'd really be interested in watching. But based on your description, that sounds like a great cult kind of type film.
It's really great. And I mean, it's kind of split between actors who can dance, like Zoe Saldana, and dancers who can act, which is most of the other... There's also, I mean, this was exciting for me in 2000. It's still exciting now. Ilya Kulik, who was a Russian figure skater, he won the gold medal at the 1998 Olympics. He's one of the dancers for no reason. He barely speaks English. And he's playing this Russian ballet dancer who his big thing is he makes out with an older woman when they go salsa dancing. Because that's another thing. Like, as much as they're committed to the ballet, they find these opportunities to be like, we just want to dance with our hearts and let loose. And so they go salsa dancing because it is 2000. And Jody takes this off-Broadway dance class to Mandy Moore's Candy, which is the soundtrack. The big emotional song on it is I Want to Be With You by Mandy Moore. So yeah, wow. Mandy Moore is like infused through it. The love triangle, all of it. It's just, you can't believe what you're watching. Highly recommended.
I've muted myself through all this, but I was just, you guys can see how much I was laughing. I obviously need to watch this.
I, like, for all that I am, like, playing up its ridiculous beats, I actually do quite enjoy this movie. Like, things like, you know, in the year 2000, the idea of dancers facing like harsh realities around their body is like, this is brand new information to them. You know, I don't, the way they talk about a dancer who has an eating disorder is just like it's brand new to them. Anytime Peter Gallagher is on screen is just really great. And then they talk about, you know, his elaborate dance history. It's, yeah. Yeah, so I recently rewatched it. It is coming up on the 25th anniversary in a couple years, and I think it's due for a critical reassessment.
Producers of that movie, Center Stage, if you're listening to this episode, and I'm sure you are, if you need to do like a DVD commentary on it, have Caroline come on. Invite Caroline to come on and do the DVD commentary with you. So it sounds like you'd be able to give some awesome insight there, Caroline.
I have so many thoughts about Center Stage. If anyone wants to talk about Center Stage, email us at podcast@epl.ca. So Bryce, what have you been enjoying lately?
So I actually have a book pick this week, and I got this pick actually from, I believe it was you, Caroline, during our Best of 2022 episode. I remember you mentioned it, and it sounded great, but the book I'm talking about is Ducks by Kate Beaton, and that is my Overdue Finds pick this week. Caroline, I believe it was like listed as maybe one of your favorite books of last year, wasn't it?
Yeah, I read it right at the end of the year, and it immediately became one of my favorite reads. Since then, I think it's gone on to win the Canada Reads competition, and I know that that's brought it to a lot of people's attention who might not normally read a graphic memoir or something about the oil industry.
Yeah, so just kind of like what you said there, if you're not familiar with Ducks, it is obviously, it's a graphic novel from Kate Beaton, which is about how basically she, along with so many others, you know, from the East Coast, who actually end up having to really look for work and leave their family to go work in the oil sands here in Alberta. But yeah, the memoir is basically Kate's story. It's about her experiences, which unfortunately aren't all positive in the oil sands. But it's a great graphic novel, and it's really, this is kind of one of those ones where, you know, I don't want to say, oh, I love books with pictures in them, but it really helps really like bring her story to life. And I mean, I think the book, let's say she just kind of wrote it as a memoir, not as a graphic novel, I still think it would be an incredible story. But there's something about the way she illustrates and just kind of the I guess the darkness of kind of the setting in northern Alberta in the oil sands is just very, very fitting. But yeah, and Caroline, you kind of touched on this too. And this is one where, you know, if you've never maybe read a graphic novel before or graphic memoir, this is a great one to start with. You know, a lot of people will kind of, connect with the character. Not character, sorry. They will connect with the author, Kate Beaton, and kind of her journey there and her working there and her story, and just obviously the setting is something that all kind of Albertans are familiar with. So graphic novels are more than just Superman and Batman, and this is a great, I would say, gateway graphic novel to start with if you've never read one before.
Yeah, it's really great. And I first became familiar with her through her cartooning. She did the strip Hark a Vagrant, did a lot of Canadian history that kind of spun it and gave it a bit of a different voice. And since then, she's done a number of things, children's books she's published. She's used her art style to write about things like the death of her sister, and now her experience with going away and leaving home. And that's there's just so much in ducks. That is, it's not just one thing. It's not just about her experience, what it's like there, but the experience to leave and what it's like to be from a community where people leave, and the way she writes about that, the way she draws that and depicts that. Ducks was a book that stuck with me. It was kind of like floating around me for a couple days after I finished it, because it was just like this kind of like book hangover, in a sense of still thinking about it, still processing it, still living a bit in that world.
All right. So today we are talking all about the new CTV show Shelved. If you're not familiar with Shelved, it's a workplace comedy centered around the lives of the employees and patrons at the Jameson Public Library in Parkdale. So this is kind of a fictional version of that library. And the show is created by Anthony Q. Farrell. He actually was a writer on The Office. And yeah, it's all about the staff and the patrons there. And hey, we're a library podcast. We need to talk about this show. This is a Canadian show set in Toronto. We must talk about this because, Caroline, we both kind of had this idea where on our libraries and pop culture episode of kind of this workplace comedy set in the world of libraries. And so now that this has come full circle, we must talk about it. So, Kate, I'm actually going to start with you here. I know you had a chance to watch a few episodes. What are your thoughts on it?
It's very cute. I wasn't sure what I was getting into, what sort of comedy it was. I have to admit, I'm not one for sitcoms. I don't usually watch sitcoms. I think it captures a lot of moments that'll be familiar to people who work in libraries or just are in libraries a lot. Obviously, as you said earlier, it is blown out of proportion. Everything is a bit more for the comedy effect, but definitely there's a lot in there that is, that's what happens in a library, because you never really know what's going to happen in a public library. So yeah, it's been cute and fun and sweet. It's funny. I had in my head, it was like a really good setup for something kind of like The Office, which it kind of has that movement where it's like a camera following these people around. I do have to say, I kind of wanted to have those moments where you're sitting down with a single person and you get there like direct to the camera feed. I kind of wanted that. Yeah, I wanted that, and it's not in there. So I was like, oh, like I feel like that could have added to it, but otherwise.
Yeah, it is very much kind of looks like The Office in a way, but I kind of almost compare it to like Brooklyn Nine-Nine, because like Brooklyn Nine-Nine, they don't do the kind of checking in with Jim in the conference room to get his thoughts on something. But yeah, I think that would definitely add to it. Caroline, how do you feel about it? Because, I believe you went to university in Toronto, didn't you?
Yes, I did. It feels to me more like a library show than a Toronto show, which I think speaks to the universalness of public libraries. I think that I was originally I would say hesitant to watch it. I think for a number of reasons. One is that sometimes when you're doing something all day, you don't necessarily want to go home and relax to the same thing, you know, like in terms of library stories. I'm in a library right now. I it's a lot. It can be a lot. And, you know, when I relax, I want to, you know, take myself to the New York ballet world and other places. But so I was a little nervous about that. I was a little nervous too about if it was going to be what people kind of thought of libraries and more of that, like, oh, this is so great. And then people who work in libraries might watch it and be like, oh, that's not really it at all. But then still have to be like, hey, have you seen this? And you see, so I was nervous about that. I think another piece of it, honestly, and we've talked a bit about this on the show before, is that I would be surprised if most people who work in libraries don't in the back of their mind somewhere have this idea of like, this will be a great story. I know I've got my notes app that has my list of ideas on it, from things that have, you know, happened or inspired by real life. And, some of it is like, well, I could do that. And I mean, I haven't, right? So that wasn't really a good reason not to enjoy something that already has been made. And so checking it out, I was really pleased to see that it was kind of escapist in a way. I think because of that heightened environment, it wasn't like I was just clocking out at work and then going home and doing more work. It was, you know, fun show to watch. And yeah, I've enjoyed the episodes so far. I think that they've been really great and have touched on a number of things that are both very general and very specific. And so it's clear that there are some library people that they've talked to at the very least around making the show.
Yeah, definitely there is someone's giving them their notes from their time at a library for sure.
Yeah, and actually it's funny, I was reading imdb.com and they did have a couple of notes on there, and they did say that several librarians were brought in to ensure basically the set was accurate, and kind of they spent, you know, some time with some of the cast and kind of going over the nuances of their jobs. So, yeah, I mean, obviously I don't work out of a branch. I work technically out of the Stanley A. Milner Library, but I don't, you know, I'm not on the front lines like both of you are. So, yeah, even little stuff that I caught too, I was like, you know, I was like, they seem to have really done their homework on this.
Speaking of the set, one of the things I couldn't help but notice as I'm watching this, and I thought of you, Bryce, many posters and all different sorts of posters for everything. And I was like, oh, marketing, you must be having a field day looking at all the different types of posters that there are. Nothing.
Oh, yeah. It's stressful watching it. But at the same time, though, like, I thought that was very, very accurate. And I don't mean this against any branches here, but you know, you see that in different branches. There's kind of maybe some homemade posters or signage that will occasionally go up, and that's fine. That stuff happens. So yeah, I did think that was very funny, and I love the running joke too, and of kind of at the start of each episode they'll show kind of there's like a small little sign that's up by the checkout desk, and I think it has like which day they're closed or something, or like hours, and it's just like crossed out and like written in pen.
Yeah,
I was just like, that's written on it.
I also love the running joke of Wendy, the branch manager, not realizing how her posters sound to other people.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
The human library episode. Yes. Yeah.
That was good. Yeah. That human library.
Yeah.
Yeah. But like overall, though, I thought, you know, I love the idea for the show. And I think it's, we've talked about this already, but like, you know, I find it to be quite funny, and the library really does make a great setting for a sitcom. Like I'm a big sitcom fan, and just the idea, it gives you so many different possibilities from obviously, you know, staff and, you know, patrons and dealing with other people in the community. I mean, I really enjoyed the show. I've watched every episode that's been out so far. So I think it's about 6 or 7 episodes have been released. And yeah, I mean, I'm definitely going to keep watching this, you know, for as long as it's on anyway. But yeah, I've got, and we'll get to it here in a little bit, but I've got so many questions for the both of you regarding some stuff I've seen in the show already.
One of the things that you've mentioned is there just the setup of it is really great. And this is something that I've talked a lot about with staff and with people. And that's the library is open to everyone. And, you know, yes, in other places, like take a show like The Office, anything can happen, But also, why would those people be visiting a paper company, right? So if you had, I don't know, like a trapeze artist and a clown drop by, why would they be visiting a paper company? I don't think I would blink if a trapeze artist and a clown came into the library. Like, we're open to everyone. And, you know, you see that in the show. And again, we'll get talking about this, but just that cross-section of, like, it could be anyone who comes in, and it's believable. It's built into the premise of what a public library is. So, yeah, we've touched a little bit on this, but the characters are really what make the show. And I'm going to start by saying, Bryce, what do you think of the character Bryce?
So I just want to take everybody back a little bit to when we were discussing this episode in our Overdue Finds team brainstorming meeting. And when Kathy Bateman brought this up, she's like, there is a character named Bryce. He has a podcast. And I was just like, wait, what? So I'm totally different than the character of Bryce, by the way. But they don't really touch on the podcast stuff too much. I think they touched on it in like the first episode, I want to say. But he's actually my favorite character on the show. Like, I find him to be probably the most interesting character. Just because, I mean, we learn, and, you know, I don't think this is going to be a huge spoiler or anything, unless you haven't watched the show. But basically, he's kind of like the Dwight Schrute of the show. And, you know, we learn, I think it's in maybe the third episode, that he's been to prison. And he's a former inmate, and he found his love for libraries when he was in prison, and he got out and went to work for a library, and now he's kind of like basically the assistant branch manager on the show. But obviously he definitely leans more conservative than pretty much the rest of the staff there. So there's an episode where they have a drag queen story time, which we've done here at EPL. And if anybody follows the news with libraries, I know it's been controversial and people unfortunately protest them. But he kind of has an issue with drag queen story time. And a lot of things too on the show, it'll be like, oh, this, you know, it's Women's Appreciation Week. So of course, then he's like, where's the Men's Appreciation Week display? So, you know, I think, you know, you need a character like that on the show to kind of like balance things out and kind of keep the story moving. But I found him to be kind of the most interesting character. It kind of seems like everybody else is kind of fits really the same mold of what you would kind of, I don't want to say what you expect from a library worker, but, you know, kind of the values that you would see within a library anyway. So I just find him to be the most interesting anyway.
He definitely is he's the voice for a lot of concerns that are like do exist in the world, or like is floating around the library world. And so he's used as that filter through which those concerns are shown in the show. As a manager, I keep thinking, oh my God, I can't imagine how many times I'd have to pull him into my office and give him a talk. So
That's one thing around there, as like Bryce, when you mentioned the staff there on the show are like right on the front lines, I kept going like maybe a bit too on the front lines. Like, why are they having their staff meeting during open hours on the public floor? Like, yes, I will suspend disbelief for, you know, the funny thing. And I think that one had a punchline of other Wendy being Otherwise, part of yeah. it, but
was there.
Yes, this is happening on the floor, and I'm just like, go to the back.
I know, and I'm saying this as I, you know, not currently, but I'm the manager of the Sprucewood branch of the Edmonton Public Library, which is a tiny branch if you've ever been there, and there is not much privacy. But yeah, we usually do take it into the program room or into my office if we're going to have a talk about something that's maybe not appropriate for the public side of things, like just discussions about the men's appreciation book list that he's coming up with. Like, maybe let's take that into the office. Yeah. So I had moments where I was just like, bleh. But it leads to some funny interactions, obviously.
Kate, did you have a favorite character?
Oh, it's funny. I think, yeah, I like Howard, actually. And I think maybe because I like see myself in him a bit awkward, a bit like nerdy about these stupid word things. And he's like, you know, wants to talk about the books he's read and his knowledge of stuff. And well, I think it was in the Women's Appreciation one where Jack says a book name and then he gets like all upset because he hasn't read it and it came out in 2017. And he just sits there like looking at Wikipedia for the next 5 minutes, just like shocked that he doesn't know this book.
One of his traits that I love is just his ability to like drop a Latin phrase in and keep going.
Yes.
And at like half of them I only pick up on because I watch with closed captioning, and because otherwise it would just go like whoosh, right over my head in terms of what he was saying. So
I just, yeah, I like his awkwardness. And
oh my gosh, that the list with the 28 items on it.
Well, just even too, like in the pilot, we see that he's coming from a different branch, and it's like one of like the more, I guess, prestigious libraries, I want to say, branches in the system. And he's just kind of like, oh, like just the idea of having to work out of this new library is like very like, yeah. I kind of had to chuckle, and I'm sure this resonates with both of you, where the first episode he comes in and he's got his jacket and he's like, oh, where do I hang up my jacket? And they're just like, oh, you just throw it on the jacket chair over there. And there's just like a pile of staff jackets. So I thought that was kind of funny.
Again, I've worked at Milner and I've worked at big libraries, and then coming to Sprucewood, it's, yeah, very much every library has its own feel and its own way of doing things. Even if you are in a system that's, you know, like EPL, where we all kind of, we float around quite a bit. But yeah, every branch has its own feel, and they've captured that quite well.
Caroline, do you have a favorite character?
I really enjoy the character Jack. I think that she is good at being kind of that instigator role for other characters, like when she tells Howard to shoot his shot with Stephanie, which is the worst advice anyone could give him. But then I think like they use her really interestingly in an episode that has one of her favorite authors coming to the library, and it turns out that the author's most recent book maybe isn't as progressive or is more problematic than her earlier works. And so like Jack comes this close to doing a literal book burning, which Wendy has to go and is like, no, we're the library, this is not what we do. And I think that kind of that challenge piece of it, of, you know, wrestling with contradictory things, which I think is something that Bryce does in the show, which is something that Howard, all of the characters really. And I just enjoy the way that they're writing Jack. I think Wendy, I go back and forth of the manager Wendy of, you know, she has these moments where it's just like, what are you doing? Why are you doing, like, no, come on. And then she has these moments where she is being an effective manager and running the branch, and some of the things and some of the ways that she said things to some of the staff. That's when I would have been taking notes going like, oh, I really like the phrasing on that.
Yes.
So I might have to use some of that. And yeah, I think just seeing that and her, I mean, I want to know more about her. I want to know, I think we have a sense of how she ended up in libraries, but I want to know more about her and kind of what drives her and why she's so committed to the work. Because I think that's such an important piece for anyone who works in libraries. So yeah, the characters they're more than just stock types. Which is, I think, very easy to do, you know, the, like, yes, Jack is, she's introduced as like, her thing is that she's the only one who knows how to run the library's social media, but that's not all she is. That's not, she's not the young one or the activist. She's multiple things. So, yeah.
I just want to touch on, like, there is so many interesting characters and they all bring something different. They're all quite unique, which I really like. We haven't talked about the other Wendy, Wendy, I think is what they call her, who I really like her just because, like, she's played by, like, a veteran comedian. And
yes.
She just, like, nails her lines so much. So, yeah, very interesting. But also, like, even the thoughtfulness about why she chooses to be unhoused and, you know, when manager Wendy tries to get her a spot somewhere, she explains why this was not the best thing for her. And I was like, I've heard those, you know, those comments before from people in the library. And I'm like, yeah, again, someone's done their homework and kind of really realized what the situation is for people, you know, who are unhoused. So that was interesting too. Or there's, like, I actually don't remember this guy, the character's name, but, like, the janitor-ish handyman kid who, like, plays video games. What is his character?
Yeah, they called him in when the water fountain was leaking.
Yeah, and he's, like, playing World of Warcraft. He's got his, like, headset on. And he's, like, just in little bits, but I really appreciate him and his little comments. I just think that each of them are very, very well done.
So let's touch on that a little bit more. I guess, you know, what are some of the other things that you think maybe they got right or even wrong about working in a library?
Oh, I mean, a lot of things, right? A lot of, like, the little concerns, the just little things that happen. I am dealing with just patrons at the desk. I love the moment where Bryce is talking to the young girl. He's trying to get her to check out a book, and she gets, like, so mad at him because she's only allowed 5 books. And I don't know, it just those little interactions.
Even that moment, Kate, if I can jump in, he's trying to get her to check out a book because Wendy is trying to get them circulating these items that so clearly should be weeded from the collection. Like, I think he's trying to move the Nintendo 64 manual, and it's just, like, even that piece of it, which is, I don't want to, like, make it overstated, but there is a tension in libraries, right, around you know, weeding for the health of a collection versus holding on to all material. So you can kind of tell which side I'm on in that one, but he is kind of doing this book push around an item that should so clearly be weeded. But then, yeah, she was hilarious when she was, like, saying, like, where would it stop? 5, 6, 7, 8?
So I really enjoyed that. The concern for someone in a bathroom, that does happen in that too. Although I personally would have tried to get into that bathroom a lot quicker than that manager did.
when she kept saying, so, like, Wendy, why aren't you answering me? I'm like,
something's happened. Yeah, I would have got in there a lot quicker. But I mean, that is something that, unfortunately, I do not every day, but it does happen where all of a sudden you're like, oh, someone in the bathroom, and I haven't heard from them in 10 minutes. I'm going to check on them and see if they're all right. And if they're not, I'm going to get in there. So those kind of things I like, and obviously, yeah, played for comedic results. And if you haven't watched that episode, I'm not going to spoil what actually is going on in the bathroom because it was quite funny. those kind of things I really liked. Like I said, the stuff happening on the floor all the time, I was like, well, if there is a tension between staff members, we're not going to air our dirty laundry in front of the public. That's a bit weird. They also seem to have a lot of time on their hands. I mean, that's the one thing I was like, why aren't you helping customers all the time? Because honestly, if you're on the desk, most of the time you are helping customers. You are printing, or you're working with them on their resumes, or you're running a program, or you're doing all these things. I was like, wow, they've just got a lot of time on their hands.
Yeah, and some of it, I think, even with all of that time on their hands, I'm still watching it going, how are they scheduling this branch?
It's true.
What are the hours?
They all seem to be there the whole day.
Who works the weekend? Like, so So I was like, you know, it's not that it's not possible. I just wanted some more details on the scheduling of the fictional staff.
Producers, if you're listening to this episode, can we have an episode on scheduling, please? Caroline, for you, I guess, was there anything that maybe really stood out to you? Like, oh my God, they nailed this, or, you know, besides the staff airing their grievances out on the floor, you know, among everybody.
One thing I thought that they did well was early on, it might even be the pilot, is that kind of that push of people to get in right when the library opens. And it turns out, I think in this case, they're trying to get study room access. I've seen it also trying to get computer access. I think one of the kind of bigger things I thought was really good in kind of like a sad way was when Howard, or Big Library as he's called, he decides he's going to fix things, and he does, but then that creates more issues for some of the things he fixes. And I find that there's always that history piece of like something that seems so obvious, like we're going to tell in the show, we're going to allow everyone to print, then that causes the printer to jam and actually cause more problems. So it seems like something that's so obvious, but there's a reason why it is the way that it is. And, you know, luckily printing is not something we have to intermediate the same way that they do on the show. But I know that there are things like that where it's like, yeah, this is for a reason, and maybe it's not a good reason, and we could probably fix the reason, but this is the reason. Yeah, like when he took the duct tape to the carpet, even that, I'm like, that's not low enough. You just created a different tripping hazard here.
Yeah. It's so true. Yeah, all that, why we do the things we do. And when you come into a new library, again, you know, having worked at many libraries, you do need to take that moment to be like, why is it like this? And find out before you start changing things.
Yeah. I think the biggest maybe suspension of disbelief, and I know that they explained this a bit in the story, but the lost library book. And I know that this is a kind of not a trope, but I mean, it's the plot of the Mr. Bookman episode of Seinfeld, in the sense of like, you know, the police or the library police will be after you for this long time. No, we don't care that much. Like, you obviously still bring your stuff back.
Please bring your stuff back.
Bring it back. We want it back. But especially when spoiler alert for the episode with the lost library book, but when they find out that the customer is deceased, like, that's the one where I'm like, if I'm Wendy and going on, okay, here are all of the things we are going to have to talk about now, me with Bryce and Howard, of why you went to this person's house. What? Just no. No.
Very true. I mean, just speaking of that trope, I always find it funny. There's always like once a year a news story that's like, this book was returned to the library after 100 years and it had $500 fines on it. I'm like, no, we kept fines. Like, what? You would never have $100. It would be like, oh, $20 is our max. We're overdue. And then we just charge you the cost of the book. So, yeah, I always find that trope, just in general, when I'm like, okay, it's done.
So, Bryce, I don't know. Do you want to get into some of your questions?
Yeah, absolutely. So, a couple of things I do want to say that I saw that I was like, oh, man, like, you. Once again, they clearly did their homework, and they do have people from the library world kind of consulting on the show. But Wendy's on the phone with the director of branch services. Like, yeah, that's an actual position. So I don't know why, but I was like, felt like the Leonardo DiCaprio meme, where, you know, he, from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, where he sees himself on TV and he points. Like, I was just I was just like, whoa, that is an actual position. The settlement desk. I don't think a lot of people, if you're not, you know, maybe you only come in the library, you know, every once in a while to pick up some holds or whatever, but, or depending on which branch you go to, like, I don't think a lot of people may realize that that is an actual thing and that there are, you know, like we have, social workers who work out of the Stanley E. Milner Library. We do have those settlement type services. So yeah, I thought that was really cool that they kind of included that. And obviously it kind of ties in with, you know, unhoused Wendy, that character and everything, and their patrons. And then too, I had to laugh because Jack was like their social media person, which I laughed at because I'm like, it made it sound like each branch has their own social media feed. And yeah, just, I don't know, if somebody who works in marketing, it's just kind of like the idea of just branches going rogue and
creating a Facebook page. I wouldn't put it past some people, but
so, and you don't need to say branches. I don't want to get anybody in trouble here. Are certain branches jealous of other branches? Because we kind of see that in the show here, where it's like, oh, this library, they got the new computers. So, like, for example, I could kind of see, you know, when we were renovating the Stanley E. Milner Library, you know, a lot of focus was put on that branch, and rightfully so, big flagship of the city. But do branches kind of get jealous of maybe what other branches get as far as amenities go or upgrades or stuff like that?
As long as there are no follow-up questions, I will say yes.
I agree. No, I mean, of course, yeah, there's things that are possible in some branches and not others. There's just like physical limitations. Again, talk about Sprucewood. It's just a small space. So, of course, you cannot do the things that you can at Milner. And yeah, it's like, oh, it'd be wonderful to be able to do this. Of course. But just sometimes you can't.
Well, I won't have any follow-up questions for you. Maybe when we go off, when we hit stop here on today's recording. So my other question for you. So this was, I think it was just in the last episode that aired. Of course, they have that competition to see who can kind of check out the most copies of their terrible books. Do you have any friendly competitions like that to see maybe who can recommend the most books or check out certain titles? And is there at times pushes to move certain titles?
Not quite like that. I mean, Caroline, I've never seen it quite like that. There is definitely like friendly competitions about other things. The YRCA books, there's like fun in-house competitions where it's like, oh, who can read the most of the YRCA titles and stuff like that. But that's internal. Externally, we might notice, oh, this area isn't moving, like people don't know about this collection, let's make a display about it.
The closest I could think of was, and this is going back a long time now, but when we first had our self-check machines, so the scanners where you can check out items yourself, it was promoted to get each branch like competing with each other to see who could have the highest percentage of checkouts done through the self-check machines. And so that was more, we were trying to let people know that we now had these and how easy it was to use them, and then encourage them if they wanted to use those to check out the materials, which is often faster than waiting at the desk. But yeah, I can't think of it. I did appreciate the emphasis on that kind of recommending, but it's a backwards way of doing it, where ideally, like, and one of the things that we love to do at the library is find that something extra for someone that thing that they didn't know they were looking for when they came in, or maybe didn't even know that EPL had, and whether that's a physical item or letting them know about one of our databases. And so having, you know, that surprise and delight moment where they realize, oh, I got more than I came in for. But it's not usually done because we're trying to push an item. I will say there was a time during the closures, so when we were doing library takeout and we had more items on the shelf, we ended up at one point with I think 12 copies of Ford versus Ferrari the movie. And we were joking that like every library takeout order comes with a free of Ford versus Ferrari. Yeah. But we didn't actually do that. We as Kate said, we made a display, we put it in the window. Yeah. And then you know, so we were finding ways to move items like that, especially at that point when people couldn't come in and browse. But yeah, it was never more than just a joke of a free copy of Ford versus Ferrari with every checkout. So we've talked here about, you know, the library being so central. This couldn't be a show that took place really anywhere else. In addition to Shelved, do you have any other favorite library moments from pop culture, Kate?
I was trying to think. I mean, I always go back to Buffy the Vampire Slayer because the first three seasons, Giles works, he's a librarian and he works out of the library in the high school, which no one ever comes into, thankfully, because they're always making their plans in there. So, I mean, just as a setting, I always enjoyed that. Although I do remember there was an episode, I think it's in the first season, maybe the second. No, it's in the second season, I think, where they get computers in the library for the first time because it was the 90s. And Giles is so anti-computer. And I'm like, that's not really a librarian trait to be like, so like, what is this newfangled contraption? I'm like, this is a bit tropey. Librarians are actually pretty open to new things. So I love that. And then I was trying to think of other library moments. I mean, I love the moment in Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade when they're in the library and he like times the like smacking down on the brick with the guy stamping his book. And I love it. I mean, he doesn't do it on purpose, but I love that scene and how he like looks at the stamp, the guy. Those are the two that came to mind.
Speaking, that reminded me of the detail from the show of when they get their new computers and Wendy, manager Wendy, says they have Netscape Navigator on them. Oh, man. Bryce, what are some of your favorite library moments?
We mentioned this already, but really the library episode of Seinfeld where we have Lieutenant Bookman, the library's detective, trying to get back their copy of Tropic of Cancer. Philip Baker Hall is hilarious in that role, and everything I've read about that, apparently like they had to do that take so many times because Jerry Seinfeld kept cracking up when he was being interrogated in his apartment. So the idea of this like dedicated like detective at the New York Public Library trying to track down books is hilarious. And that to me, and I mean, I love Seinfeld. I've talked about it endlessly on this show, but yeah, that one's really good. And also for me too, the library staff on Parks and Recreation. Now the library is seen as this like evil entity, and and the staff are just like rude, especially to the parks and rec people, and that always cracks me up on that show.
I do always find it funny, I guess, speaking of library tropes, how librarians are often like portrayed as being quite mean and rude and like closed off and don't touch my books. I mean, yeah, I have moments where I'm like, bleh, but again, that's not really libraries. And so it's funny that that is a stereotype of librarians to be like that.
One of my favorite ones, I talked about it, I think, in our libraries and pop culture episode, and that's the Billy Eichner character on Bob's Burgers, and Mr. they Ambrose. Go to the library. Yeah, Mr. Ambrose, and they're looking up story, and he's, you know, just whispering about Topsy, or another episode where he's like, I start things, I don't finish them, and you know, just the way that he stirs the pot in the libraries, and is really, I find that quite funny. And I mean, the Breakfast Club is probably one of the most iconic library set movies. You know, again, I guess library seen as a place of punishment. Yeah, not the best, but on there. But for more of our thoughts on libraries, really encourage people to go back and listen both to the libraries and pop culture episode, as well as the episode we did on The Public, which was the Emilio Estevez movie that came out and took a more serious look at some of the things that we've been talking about today. But definitely in that one as well, we also talk about, you know, what it's like to work in a library. Before we get to our roundtable questions, Bryce, can you let our listeners know what is coming up on our next episode, which will be released on Friday, May 5th?
So we just wrapped up another year of March Madness, where we crowned Darth Vader as the best villain. So on the next episode of Overdue Finds, we'll be taking a look back at the Star Wars franchise and explore why Darth Vader deserved to be named best villain. Caroline, I haven't discussed this with you yet, but maybe we'll release that episode a day early on May the 4th.
Ooh, that's that marketing brain at work right here.
That's right. Sorry, they pay me the big library bucks to think of ideas like that. So, all right, quick roundtable questions time. I'm so excited for your responses on this one. Kate, you've been hired to help write an upcoming episode of Shelved. What storyline are you proposing to the producers?
You know, I actually had a hard time thinking of this because I was like, well, they've hit on some stuff already. But one of the things they haven't really, I mean, I haven't watched the most recent episode, and obviously there's more coming up, but I was like, so much about like summer reading club to me. And that's such a huge part of libraries. And like, I mean, yes, the fun stuff with all the kids, but also like, I don't know, the back end of organizing it all is actually quite a lot. And so I could see there being like a lot of, oh, we want to do this, oh, that, juggling all the things and having, you know, probably rude kids come and say stuff because that's what kids always do in sitcoms. They just speak their mind. And I don't know, I feel like there's something there with the summer reading club. And again, that's something that pretty much everyone knows, some version of summer reading club, whatever it's called in your sort of library system.
Yeah, the idea of Bryce being at the registration desk for the summer reading club, that in itself yes. would be very funny.
Or Bryce doing a program, I don't know, like trying to entertain kids. Yeah. That's one thing, yeah, they don't have to do a lot of programming on the show that I've seen, whereas I'd say a lot of like staff who do work on the floor do a lot of programs in real life.
It's the other staff, the ones we're not seeing are the ones,
the ones like, we're not seeing, almost the background. Like a night court vibe
of like, yeah. this is the overnight staff of the library.
Well, it's funny because there are a couple scenes where they would like cut to somebody and you could tell they're very obviously a library staff member, like they don't have names or anything, and you only see them for like a minute or so. But Caroline, what I'm so excited to hear your recommendation. What storyline are you pitching the producers of Shelved?
It's going to revolve around someone getting a library card for their dog, signing them up for an account, and then when they bring the dog to the library, you know, they're told you can't have the dog in the space, and then it becomes, well, why would you allow the dog to become a member if you're not going to let them use the facility? And then they realize that they had registered what they thought was a child, but is actually a dog for a library card. And then it goes from there. I don't know quite how it gets resolved, but I think there's something around that.
My follow-up question, has that happened in real life?
I don't think so. No.
Like, have you experienced this?
No. I have had people to register their, like, soon-to-be-born child for a library card. But no, I don't think I've ever registered a pet.
Yeah.
You know, someone says, oh, I want to get a card for little Ralphie. And someone's like, oh, well, you know, how old it's exactly. And, you know, he's into everything these days. And, you know, they're talking. And then, like, the next day, the person comes back and is, like, with the dog. And it's like, oh, the dog will have to stay outside. Like, but this Ralphie has been looking forward to this all day. It's like, well, your son can stay, but the dog needs to leave. But the dog is Ralph, you know, so, yeah.
I love how fully formed your idea was. Mine was just a vague sense of this could be a fun setting. Yours is like, here is the story.
I don't know. It just came to me. I honestly have not been thinking about this for a long time. But once I had the kernel, I can kind of see how it plays out. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Bryce, what do you think would be a good storyline?
All right, so they've touched on this a few times on the show. They'll reference head office as, you know, head office is doing this or they're doing that. So obviously as somebody who, you know, technically would fall under head office and marketing, I would love to see marketing cast as kind of almost like the villain on the show. So my idea for the episode would be that marketing or head office has this terrible idea to introduce staff uniforms. And they're pushing staff uniforms onto branch staff. And of course, being in marketing, we're like, this is our brand and this is how we want to, you know, appear to our patrons and the community and everything like that. So my episode would be on us introducing these horrible looking and very uncomfortable, naturally, uniforms, and the library system and staff kind of trying to fight back and say, this is why these uniforms wouldn't work. It would just seem like something terrible that marketing would recommend. And I personally would never recommend that, but I think that would make for a pretty funny episode.
I think so too. Like I had a reaction just to you saying, oh, yeah, that. Exactly. I was like, I can already picture what staff are going to say.
All right. So last question, of course, Shelved is a Canadian show. We love our Canadian TV. Kate, what is your all-time favorite Canadian TV show?
This is hard. You know, thinking back, I was like, oh, you know, I really enjoyed Orphan Black. And I was just thinking, and then I was like, you know what? Those aren't my all-time favorite. Like, my all-time favorite is Mr. Dressup. That just is. That has to be. I know. He helped raise me as a child and my whole generation, I think. I saw him in concert once in person. Yeah, he came to Vancouver and did a show on stage, and I got to see him. So, yeah, Mr. Dressup for me. Ultimate, just an all-around good guy and a fun show. But there is so many good Canadian shows out there that sometimes I forget our Canadian SCTV. I mean, This Hour is 22 Minutes. I remember loving, I don't watch it now, but, you know, it's a classic. So hard to choose, but Mr. Dressup.
Caroline, how about you? Your all-time favorite Canadian show.
This was definitely tough. I also went to childhood thinking mine was Today's Special, which was the TV show set I can't remember if it was Simpsons Department Store or if it was like a knockoff of Simpsons Department Store. But anyway, it was a Toronto department store, and it was about Jody, who also was the ballet dancer, no relation. But she was like did the displays at the thing. Anyway, there was the mannequin who came to life. There was the security guard. There was Muffy the mouse, who spoke in rhyme and had this gorgeous apartment with a little elevator in it that was like apartment goals for, you know, little 4-year-old Caroline. But Today's Special was definitely a show I watched a ton of and, you know, really impacted me at the time. I think probably technically Degrassi might be my actual answer, but my heart is going to go with Today's Special.
It's so funny. When you said the name of it, I was like, I don't know that show. Yeah. But then you described it and I went, oh, of course I know that show. For some reason I didn't remember the title of it. And it's funny, Degrassi, I thought about it. But I have to be honest, the only time I watched Degrassi was when we had sex education at school and they
Yeah.
played episodes of it. So I never watched it as a show.
Yeah. I had to do in my grade 13 class. I can't remember why. I can't remember why, but I had to do a presentation on the something. Anyway, I just showed an episode of Degrassi.
Nice.
It had to be like a 30-minute presentation. The episode was 25 minutes. I showed the entire thing, including the unrelated subplot, and everyone was like, "Yeah, it works." It's just what high school was at the time. Bryce, how about you?
So Caroline, I joked with you about this on our kind of our chat, and I was going to pick The Littlest Hobo, but then I remembered I love the theme music, but the actual show itself isn't actually very good.
I've never made it past like 5 minutes.
No, it does not hold up. It's not, and it's like, you know, if you were a lot of people will, you know, joke about sometimes the quality of Canadian television. And The Littlest Hobo would be the definition of cheesy Canadian television.
Yes.
So it's not my pick, but I just want to. We could do a whole episode
Had
on
to
The
put it out
Littlest
there.
Hobo. Yeah. Anyway, my pick. I don't know if this counts because it's not scripted per se, but Hockey Night in Canada.
Oh, sure.
It's
I
a.
mean, that's a classic
Yeah,
Canada
it's
show.
like ingrained in our culture here as Canadians.
That theme song.
Yeah, families sit down and watch it together.
Yeah. When I went to, I was in band in high school and we went to Germany in 2000. It's kind of our capping off graduation. We played at the Expo in Germany. And we played that song on the Canada stage every time we played because it was like, this is what Canada is.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Probably brought the house down playing that. But I will say, though, if I had to pick a scripted show, it would probably be Degrassi Junior High. High would be my pick.
Thank you so much for joining us today, Kate. Is there anything coming up for Capital City Press that you would like listeners to know about?
There are so many things. And we've had a lot of people showing up for our programs. They're all online still. Our writer in residence, Kate Borman, has been doing some amazing programs. She's got an event coming up on May 11th called Revision, Clarify and Elevate. So it's about, you know, taking your novel to the next level through revising it, which sometimes people might find a bit intimidating. So register online for that. As I said, May 11th, 7 p.m. on Zoom. We also have another Capital City in Conversation coming up, our first one of the year, May 24th online. And this one's called Edmonton's Food Scene. And we have quite the lineup for it. So I'll be hosting a conversation with Mary Bailey, who's the editor and owner of The Tomato, Lindsay Porter, a chef who competed on Top Chef Canada, Kevin Kosowin, a forager, hunter, and food generalist, and Patricia Milligan, who works with Edmonton Urban Farm. So we're going to talk about everything cool going on in Edmonton's food scene. I also want to plug, just because I'm here and I can, not Capital City Press related, but just something fun that's happening at the Strathcona Library that I'm hosting, May 4th, 7 p.m., Pop Culture Club. We're going to start this new program, Pop Culture Club. I wanted to call it Culture Club, but apparently, you know, that maybe is something else, I don't know.
I may
So
have been
May
involved
4th,
in that
7 p.m.
conversation.
May 4th, 7 p.m. It's called Getting Started with D&D. So if you are interested in Dungeons and Dragons, if you've seen the movie and want to know more about what the actual game's about, you can come on down to Strathcona Library and we're gonna talk about character creation, what resources are out there if you want to start your own game, and just meet other people who are interested in the game and maybe you can start your own campaign together. So I'll be hosting that and I'm super excited about it.
Wow. Neat. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode. Make sure that you're subscribed to the show so that you get all of our new episodes. Please also leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. Most importantly, tell a friend about the show. Maybe someone you like to go to the library with.
Don't forget that we'll have a link to everything that we talked about in today's show notes, We love to hear from our listeners. So send us an email at podcast@epl.ca and let us know what you think maybe of this episode. Or if you've watched the TV show Shelved, let us know what you think of it. And yeah, Caroline and I absolutely love to receive emails. You can also share your thoughts about the show with us on Twitter at epl.ca and use the hashtag EPLOverdueFinds. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you next time.